Today I want to talk about the tongue. Amen. Tongue. Amen. That tongue, boy. Oh, Father. Help us here today. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. That tongue. Amen. How much people that tongue put in trouble? I want to talk about that tongue. I want to address that tongue. I'm looking at the Word of God. We are going to the Proverbs chapter 18. Proverbs the 18th chapter. And we like to read the 21st verse of Proverbs the 18th chapter and the 21st verse. The scripture reads, Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Death and life. In other words, you can speak death, or you can speak life with your tongue. Let me hasten to tell you what 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 10 says. 1 Peter 3:10 says, he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips, that they speak no guile. I love the clause to the top of this verse here. He that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue. In other words, let him or her be careful with how they speak. And I guess all of us here love life. Listen to me, I love life. I'm glad to be alive. Let me see all of you who are glad to be alive. Amen. Oh, I'm glad to be alive. Yesterday I had a beautiful day, you know. Yesterday was baptism. Amen. I told the folks in the go do the baptism, because today is my son's birthday and I am going to enjoy my son. He turned 24 yesterday. So I said to him, let's go for lunch. My wife and myself took him for lunch at the Hyatt. And boy, listen to me. I woke up, amen, refreshed myself. Amen. I just got excited about going out yesterday with him to have a birthday breakfast. Boy, amen. He was happy too that he don't have to pay for it. Amen. Amen. I'm taking care of breakfast for the family. And we sat there at the Hyatt, and one of my members who work in the kitchen in the Hyatt saw me there and said, Pastor, oh my God. And before long, amen, she brought a beautiful salad bowl, fresh, also steam vegetables. So, amen. One of the guys who's serving, he said, somebody must know you here. Amen. Amen. They just send that because it's not on the menu, the breakfast menu. They just sent it out. And then I happened to tell one of the girls there that, you know, it's my son's birthday. Because they too knew me. And they said, amen, you and your whole family? I said, yeah. They went and, amen, they fixed him a nice slice of cake with a, amen, signature happy birthday. Oh, we chatted and we hang there for about an hour and a half. Amen. And then we went for a drive. My son and myself, my wife went home, and the boys had some boy time. So we went and looked at some vehicles. You know, he wanted to get a new vehicle. So he went to, and listen to me, it was just a, I was enjoying it, man. Amen. I got home, and when I got home, amen, after lunch, I just relaxed, amen, got up in my bed, took a sleep, amen, got up, and then remember I had some stale group of soup in the broth in the kitchen, amen, got out in the kitchen and warm up that group of, oh, Father, amen, came out to church, amen, got back home, enjoyed yesterday's service. Amen. That was just a beautiful day. Got home. Amen. Cuck up in my bed. Watch a little TV. There's some china in my hand. And I just, amen, just watch television. Beautiful day. I don't know. I just told you that to let you know you can have good days. And God wants you to enjoy your days. Watch it. He that will love life and see what? Good days. You don't want nobody up in your face cussing you out. Amen. You don't want your, amen, to upset your wife or upset your husband or upset your children, and everything is tense in the house, and you can't even go and say, can you go to sit down to have a meal, and everything is, amen, it's like, amen, the war of the galaxies, amen, everything gonna clash here, amen, and you're gonna have a disaster. You don't want that. So the word of God says, amen, that he that will love life and see good days, refrain your tongue. Because what you say could mess up your day. What you say can mess up your days. And refrain your lips from speaking rubbish. You know, I was a couple came to see me recently, and the wife began to rant, and the husband, he crossed his legs, and he's just sitting there, and I'm telling her, cool it, stop getting on like that, and he is saying, Pastor, leave it so, because you see, if I say anything here, it will get worse. Can I speak like how they're speaking? It's going to get worse. Leave it so. I said, no. I said, why are you saying those things? Amen. And she said to me, I know why I say it. I just saying these things to see how he will respond. So I said, you know, you don't really mean what you say. She said, no. I like to do them things to see how he's going to respond. I said, oh, listen to me. I immediately said, I wish Sister John would be here so she would learn not to do this. Listen to me. And I want you to know, this is not just this woman's case. This is a life lesson that so many people silly practice. They speak out of time, and they speak guile, they speak rubbish. And as a result of that, it disrupts their peace. It disrupts their relationships with people. Don't you ever think for one moment that what you say has no effect. I want to make it absolutely clear this morning that what you say can be very pertinent. You have to be careful with your mouth. The Word of God says that death and life are in the power of the tongue. Now, it is also important that you realize that the tongue can cause a whirl of fire. In fact, the Word of God tells us in the book of James, let's take a look at it. in the book of James, chapter 3 and verse 6. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. I want to stop there. The tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. Now, iniquity is sin, but it is not just only sin. Iniquity represents presumptuousness. Presumptuousness. In that, James is saying, don't you ever be deliberate in what you are doing, particularly when you are communicating. Because you will always find yourself in confusion with the opposing forces that you relate to. It is extremely important that you recognize, as James goes on to say, so is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body and set on fire the course of nature. And it is set on fire of hell. How many people have allowed all hell to break loose with their relationships, whether it is relationships that may deal with the family, or relationship that may deal with colleagues, or relationships that may deal with the neighborhood, all because of a lack of control as it relates to one thinking before they speak, one recognizing the repercussions that their speech will bring or cause in the midst of their environment, and one carelessly use their tongue mischievously or carelessly creates major conflict, and so on. It goes on to a total disruption of their lives. It is so important to know that you are the one. You are the one. No one can do this for you. No one can control your tongue. You can get the best trainer in tongue to try to control your tongue. And if this is the way you feel, you are going to express this yourself the way you feel. You know, some people say, I just like to talk as I feel. Then, amen, then if you feel that you can fly, then you should go to the top, amen, of the Twin Towers and throw yourself down. But even though as much as you feel that you can fly, amen, you know that common sense tells you that gravity is not going to hold you up there because you're not a bird. You're suicidal in what you're about to do. And so in like manner, you have to understand that you got to be careful about how you speak and how you relate to people. It is even so more important that you should always know that you live in communities, whether it's the community of your family or the community of your neighborhood or the community of your workplace or whatsoever community may be the place of prayer or the place of play, that you have to be very careful as it relates to how you communicate to people. The Word of God tells us in James chapter 3 and verse 8, the tongue no man can tame, but you can. We cannot do it for you. But you can. You can. The word of God says, if you just let your tongue just rant, you would become victim to the unruly evil of it. And what will be the result of it will be death. The tongue can be deadly. It can, be deadly poison. I watch these two words here. James could have easily said it is an evil, but James wanted to punctuate what he was saying. So he said, you see that tongue? It is an unruly evil. Amen. If you're not in control of yourself, you will break all the rules with what you say to damage people. James just didn't stop there, but James went on to say, the tongue is not just poison, it's a deadly poison. So it is so important for us to bring ourselves to the place where we bridle our mouths. We bridle our mouths. In fact, James, who speaks so much about the tongue, in James 1:26 says that if you're religious, bridle your tongue. Because if you cannot bridle your tongue and you call yourself religious, you have deceived yourself. And your religion is in vain. You have deceived yourself, and your religion is in vain. So I don't want my church here, or any Christian group for that matter, to be filled with a whole lot of witchy-poos. Now, another thing that we have to be careful of is that we must not use our tongue to be a forked tongue. When you say forked tongue, Pastor, what are you talking about? I'm talking about a double tongue. You know, there are some people, amen, they can talk nice with you. Oh, how sweet they're talking with you. And by the time they turn their back, such a stupidness. You old boy, you go to the next person and say, but I tell you, there's such a nastiness. Oh, God, you should see how they are. Yeah, and the next person's so conceited and deceitful to listening to you with all your garbage. And they then go back, amen, and tell the same person who you spoke about, amen, about what you said, amen, or go and tell another friend of theirs who is a friend of that person, and come back and that person go back, and the thing make a whole wrongs, and come back and tell you the next person. Look at how much confusion. If you'd have just only mind your own business. If you had only mind your own business. You know, in matters like these, you have to tell yourself, you see, listen to me, I'm not interested in my ears ain't no garbage bin. You gotta come stand up and tell people that my ears ain't no garbage bin. Amen. You know, I'm not interested in what you're saying. Amen. My ears ain't no dump. You see, you got to recognize that God tells us in His Word that no traitor shall enter the kingdom of God, according to to Galatians chapter 5 and verse 19 and going down, amen, there you see all those who will not enter the kingdom of God, amen. You see a list of them, verse 20, lasciviousness, amen. And it goes down, the list keep going down, amen. It tells you those who will not enter the kingdom of God. Why? Because, you see, God does not want you to live in confusion. Now, I don't want to recommend this because this is the way I live my life. I try to live my life with a small circle. Amen. I try to live my life with a small. You can say what you want. I'm a pastor of a big church, but amen, when it comes to my personal life, my circle is small. Amen. I could count about five persons in my circle. Finding five persons in my circle for my, amen, who I could let my hair down with. Amen. I don't have much hair to let down. Amen. 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 But who I could open up. Amen. Amen. Expose a little bit of my nakedness with. Amen. Amen. They're less than five persons. All because, amen, there are people, amen, who are very mischievous with their tongue. Very, very mischievous with their tongue. You have to be so careful who you invite into your circle. You have to be so careful, I repeat, who you invite into your circle. Not that you're playing anything, you know, you're better than anybody, you know. Amen. Not at all. Amen. 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 There's an old Chinese saying, you choose your horses from tens of thousands. But the people, amen, you choose your horses from thousands, rather. Amen. But the people who you invite in your circle, you choose them from tens of thousands. The people who you invite into your circle. Why? Because, you see, you have to protect yourself. It is so critical that you protect yourself. And particularly, people who are in leadership roles. People who are in leadership roles. Amen. First Timothy chapter 3 and verse 8 says that people are in leadership roles should not be double-tongued. They should not. People who are confidants, amen. People who are that close to you should not be, amen, speaking. One minute they're speaking for you, and next minute they're speaking against you. You don't want, amen, to get tied up with them kind of thing. Just touch somebody next to you and say, don't get tied up, please. Don't get tied up. Don't get tied up. Don't get tied up, amen. You know, watch at this verse in Proverbs 18:19. In Proverbs 18:19, the word of God says, a brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city. A brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city. And their contentions are like the bars of a castle. In other words, when you offend somebody and they close up, it's like the bars of a castle. That's major security. You don't want to live, amen, particularly with your spouse. You don't want to live particularly with business partners. You don't want to live particularly with colleagues. You don't want to live personally with people of the same house of worship or the same institution that you belong to, that you have to, amen, to have a war zone because of what you have said with your mouth. You don't want to create that kind of poisonous environment. You don't want to. Because the Word of God tells us that the tongue will do that. The tongue will create that kind of poison in our environment. If you continue to spew out negatives, if you continue to spew out deadly stuff, it will affect people's lives. Let's look at the flip side of it. We spoke about the negative. First John chapter 3 and verse 18 tells us. This is John speaking as a spiritual father. So he is saying, little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. John is saying, let the tongue communicate truth. In fact, Paul writing to the church at Colossae, says to the church at Colossae, he says to them, I want you, my brethren, to know that when we minister to one another, we minister nourishment. Not medicine. You know, some people feel that they are God's gift to just always telling you about all about your past. They are the prophets of your past. They are the prophets of your present. They are the prophets of what is to come in your life. Listen to me. Anytime you give people that kind of permission to cause you to feel down and to cause you to feel that you are less than, you have given them too much power. You have given that to them too much power. God has blessed you with life. And the life that God has blessed you with, I want to, just let me just say something as the way I feel the Spirit of God is leading me to say it. Because the best of us sitting here have made mistakes. The best of us sitting here have made mistakes. The best of us have not fulfilled what we feel is our heart's desire. Some of us have started and have stopped certain things that we felt if we had disciplined ourselves to it, we would have become successful in it. And we feel sometimes as failures because we did not pursue it to the end or finished it. Some of us have met some unfortunate situations in life where life has brought challenges to us, and we have met disappointments, we have had broken relationships, or we have had divorce, or a spouse may have died, and a lot of our plans and wishes may have crumbled with it. But too often what happens is not someone now coming to bring injury to us. It is we now injuring ourselves. And this is even more grave when you are using your own mouth to poison yourself by making negative confessions of yourself. Because of your failures, because of your disappointments, because of the loss of your expectancies, you are now inwardly afflicting yourself by how you think of yourself. Now, observe what the Word of God says, and it is so profound. The Word of God says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. You have to be so careful that you do not use your own speech to now begin to speak your downward career. I want to say that again. That you don't use your speech now to determine your downward career. Because as dark as it is, your best days are not over. As dark as it is, I want to repeat it. Your best days are not over. You have to be filled with hope. You have to be filled with hope. Because there is such grace from God that is upon you as a child of God. There is such grace. And this is where we go back to James. Because James reminds us that a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways or her ways. So that you have to, in spite of what is happening or what surrounds your life presently, that you don't allow what people have spewed upon you or what, amen, what life has offered to you, for you to say that you have reached or plummeted. Amen. You have already, amen, failed, and there is no hope. I want you to know that is not God's plan for you. God's plan for you is always that there are better days ahead of you. Better days ahead of you. The situation may be very bad right now. I tell you this. I was going to preach in California for the Gethsemane Love Baptist Church. Amen. Fundamental Baptist Church in California, Avalon Boulevard. I was excited because so many things happens, amen, in Avalon Boulevard, amen, historically, amen. And this is one of these great churches. Bishop Jackson pastors their church, and he invites me to preach. My first visit to California, too. So it's in the winter time, and I go to the New York airport. And when we boarded the plane, oh my goodness, amen, everything looked pretty all right. And while sitting on the tarmac there, the plane, amen, a mist dropped. And you could see nothing. And then apart from the mist dropping, snow began to fall and began to cover the top of the plane while the pilot waits to get the clearance to fly out. We sat there for more than 3 hours. And then the pilot comes on and says to us that they are going to de-ice the plane, which means is that they're going to take off the snow off of it. And they use a chemical, and it's going to have a scent coming into the plane. And I'm saying, the devil is a liar. Get us off this plane. Amen, amen. Get us all more than 3 hours, and now you're telling me you're going to de-ice the plane, and that scent is coming in, and de-ice the plane. And they said, but you see, the situation was already a bad situation, and I realized that they are not going to take us off this plane. They're going to fly this plane off. And I try to make myself as comfortable as possible in a bad situation. You see, you got to learn what it is when you're already in a bad situation. You got to learn what it is to recoil. You got to learn to know how to adjust yourself. Because some of you are facing some bad, bad situations. People have already said their nastiness. They have made your name bad. Amen. They've already messed up your situation. What has happened has happened. Amen. You cannot change it. You are on the flight. You're on the flight. This has already happened. And I sat there, amen, and I started to talk to God. I said, God, we're going to have to make this safely, you know. Amen. I saw people pull out chaplains, people pull out beads, people pull out little New Gideon, New Testaments. I never knew people travel so armed, amen, because we've been down there so, amen, so long, amen, that people felt, amen, there's something going to happen at all. All of a sudden, the mist lifted, and the pilot said, well, we got clearance to leave. But while we were getting clearance to leave, and the plane lifted about 5,000 feet off the ground into the flight, we lifted straight into the heaviness. And that plane began to shake. Rock. Rock. And the pilot comes on and begins to speak. I love after the fact, I began loving the pilot after the fact. He began to speak, and he began to say these words, we are going higher. He said, be comfortable. We are coming out of this. We are going higher. And he said, the higher we go is the clearer it's becoming. The higher we go is the clearer we're becoming. The higher we go is the clearer it's becoming. He said, we are about 35,000 feet now, and everything, we're above everything. From here on, I'm seeing a smooth passage. Amen. The higher we went, the clearer it became. I want you to know, in spite of how you are in it, you're already in it. But just look to God. Lift your head as unto the hills from whence comes your help. Your help comes from the Lord, because God has, amen, a silver lining above the misty shadows that cover your life. Don't give up. Don't you give up in spite of all the challenges that you face in life. Don't take your own tongue and condemn yourselves. Stop doing it. In the name of Jesus Christ, I want you to stop doing it. In fact, the Word of God teaches us even to pray this way. The Word of God teaches us that we should pray that the Lord will forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Amen. That we will forgive those, amen, who trespass against us. You must know, amen, you must know as a child of God, amen, that God wants you, amen, to hold on to your peace. Amen. God wants you to hold on to your faith. God wants you to hold on to your future. I want you to know, I want to tell you today, I want to make it a statement of fact, amen, that the Word of God says that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. So if somebody took their tongue and they tried to nasty your life, I want you to know that that tongue has to go down to the powerful name of Jesus Christ, and God can lift the beggar from the dunghill, and God can cause the beggar to sit among princes. God can turn it around for you. Amen. I close with this. A young man by the name of Jonathan, the son of Saul, King Saul, during David's most critical times of his life, where his death looked most certain, Jonathan spoke prophetically kind words to him. In so much that the Word of God says that Jonathan loved David as his own soul. Because he, instead of speaking in words of guile and mischief so that David could have been trapped by his own father who wanted to kill David, Jonathan looked out for David so that David's life was spared many times because of the way Jonathan guided him and spoke to him. I want you to know, don't you ever feel that you are the only pebble in the ring or on the beach? There, the man that you, or the woman that you would live life with, that you may have the opportunity to rescue or to assist. Someday, or one day, maybe your own child might need the assistance of this person. That's why, in spite of people's situations, bad situations, you do not laugh at them or feel that you are better than them. Because you don't know that same man who you are meeting on your way up may be the very said man that you may have to pass on your way down. See, David understood that principle in life. And David realized that he had to be there. In fact, so Jonathan learned that principle in life and realized that he had to be there for David. because he could have helped you. There are people you can help. There are people that you can reach out to. You can reach out to. Don't take your mouth and join in with others. Don't you go on other people's parades that you should have no business in. Amen. Let them mind their own business. And you keep going. You keep going. Don't get in people's confusions. You see, Jonathan had a son. And Jonathan died young. And it was a very sad situation for Jonathan's son. When he was a child, his maid was running with him and he fell out of her hand and became a cripple. And now Jonathan and Saul is gone. And there are some mean people by the name of Abner. Who wanted to kill out Saul's family. And they took, there were some people who took Jonathan and hid him. Jonathan's son, rather, and hid him. Hid him in a place called Lodibar, a place known as Dong Lo. Dong Lo. He was in a place where he was very, very impoverished. In a bad state. In a bad state. A cripple in a bad state. Sometimes that's how our lives feel. There's not much we can do in the place we are in. We are in some bad places. Oh, bad places. Bad places. You know, I'm really touched now because I remember, a parent telling me, how they used to pray for their daughter's children. And their daughter came and died. And they prayed for the children. And they said, Pastor, it's amazing how life could change. She said to me, those children make me proud now, Pastor. They just didn't remain in that place. They got out of that place and they took me too out of that place. You don't know what is ahead of you. Your place may be a bad place now. Like Jonathan's son, whose name is Mephibosheth. One day David, While just walking, David remembered Jonathan, and God dropped a thought in his heart to bless anybody who he can find that is related to Jonathan, who is now dead. And one of his servants heard David saying that if he could do anything to help somebody from the Jonathan clan, and the servant said, yeah. He has a son in Lodibar. He's a cripple. And David say, send for him. They got him clean up and they brought him to David. David made him to sit at his table. And when Jonathan's son, Mephibosheth, sat at the table, he watched at David and he said, who am I but a dog to sit at the king's table? Listen to me. God has a unique way to take you up in spite of your situation and put you at king's tables. He lifts the beggar from the dunghill. He lifts the beggar from the dunghill and he causes them to sit among princes. Don't you allow your being low down, to allow you to speak of yourself worse than you should. Because I serve a God who sits in the heaven, who delights, in promoting people's lives. And I will always live that way because I've seen it. I've even experienced it in my own life, that God can change bad situations and give to people hope and give to them life. Your situation can change. More quicker than you think because of the greatness of our God. Don't let people's tongues damage you, and don't you use your tongue to damage people. And neither do you take your tongue to damage yourself. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Come on and stand for prayer. Amen. Lift your hands and start talking to God today.